sahanau bhunaktu saha viryam karavavahai tejasvinavadhitamastu ma vidvishavahai om shanti shanti shantih samasta jana kalyane niratam karunamayam Sadgurum Brahma Vidvaram Sachidananda Rupaya Vishwot Patyadi Hetave Tapatraya Vinashaya Shri Krishna Ravayam Namaha Hariyom, salutations to all. So, we were seeing the women of Hastinapur, how they have praised Bhagwan. And in that, there is one portion where they say that how blessed are the people in Dwarka and how they must have done lot of tapas, vrata, got lot of punya to be able to have darshan of Bhagwan in Dwarka itself. Except the time when Bhagwan is out, most of the time when he is there, so they are blessed because that is their, that is his abode. And there he stays with his eight principal consorts, wives. Who are these eight wives? So Rukmini, Satyabhama, Jambavati, Kalindi, Nagnajiti, Mitravrinda, Mitvinda, Lakshmana and Bhadra. These are eight wives of Krishna Bhagavan. It is not all are, only three are mentioned here. Rukmini, Jambavati and Nagnajiti. These three are mentioned. Jambavati. So Satyabhama, Kalindi, Mitvinda, Lakshmana, Bhadra. These are the other five. So these are eight whom he had married for, you know, through different ways. Here it is said who were carried off as prizes of valor at an assembly of suitors after vanquishing powerful princes like Shishupal and others who were brought in thousands after slaying the demon Naraka. So these 16,000 were after killing Narakasura. And these eight were through Swayamvar or through, like Rukmini was, you know, she had sent a letter to Bhagwan that she wants to marry only the Lord. And Bhagwan kidnapped her as though. So they were thinking about, they were praising these eight wives also and how blessed they are, how lucky they are and how noble they are. These women brought sanctity to an exalted womanhood. So now, having said all that, Bhagwan now moves. He smiles at this, all the ladies who have given the so much of praise, he smiles at them, he acknowledges that, and now he starts moving. Yudhishthir, he senses some danger may come to him from the enemies of Bhagwan, because Bhagwan has been one of the main people for this Mahabharata war for Pandavas to win. So then he sends his one portion of his army with the Lord. We think Bhagwan needs protection. Who needs protection? Bhagwan protects all of us. But he is doing his Raj Dharma. As a king, he is sending. So one group goes and then Bhagwan tells all of them, Pandavas, to go back. They are very attached to him. They don't want to go back. Imagine Bhagwan is going away. Who will want Bhagwan to go away? If some devotee feels, Acha hai, Bhagwan ja rahe hai, then that person is not a devotee. whenever Bhagwan goes, whoever is a devotee is going to feel miserable. And Pandavas are specially attached. So he tells them to go back. They follow the instructions, they go back, and then he passes through all these different places they have given here. Kuru Jangala, Panchal, Shurasena, Mathura, and stretching on the banks of Yamuna, Brahmavarta, Kurukshetra, Matsya, Saraswata, Marudhanva. Bhagwan reached the kingdom of Anartha, that is Gujarat. Now every place where he passes, see the last line where he says that. That wherever he passes, the people residing there, they honored Bhagwan. And at dusk, what would Bhagwan do? He would alight from his car and repairing to some lake, say his sandhya prayers. Sayam bheje disham paschad gavishtho gam katastada. So he would do his evening sandhya prayers. So this sandhya vandan is a surya upasana. That is something that is prescribed for all the people. Three varnas it is prescribed for, Brahmana, Kshatriya and Vaishya. Why it is not prescribed for Shudra? Because the mindset is not yet ready for that, that's all. More of hard work, labor, that suits them. Contemplation, etc. doesn't. So it's not a question of caste discrimination. It's a question of going by the temperament. In the earlier days, the devatas used to be propitiated with havans. Now these devatas are in the invisible form. Indra, Varuna, Vayu, all of them. But Surya Devata is pratyaksh. So you can see, and as a symbol of the devata is the sun as the star also. And so if you see even in earlier avatars, so Bhagavan Ram also did Surya Upasana, and he chanted that Aditya Hridayam, and he got blessings, then he fought with Ravan. Yamaraj also worships Surya Devata. Yama and Yami are actually brothers and sisters. And who is their father? Surya Devata. So Yamaraj also worships Surya Devata. Bhagavan Ram worships Surya Devata. Yudhishthir worships Surya Devata. When they were in the exile, that Akshay Patra was given to Yudhishthir by Surya Devata. Krishna Bhagavan also sets the same example, though he is Bhagavan avatar. He himself says, no, in the Gita, Jyotisham Ravi Ramshuman, amongst the luminaries, I am the sun. The brilliance in the sun, the ability to give light and heat, is from Bhagavan. Still, Bhagavan doesn't say that you are shining because of me, why should I worship you? He sets, that is called setting dharma samsthapana. These are smaller ways by which Bhagavan sets dharma samsthapana. If Bhagavan himself is doing that, then that is what everybody else has to follow. If he himself is going to Gurukul and having a guru and surrender and learn, then he is setting dharma, the standards of dharma, which everyone has to follow. So every place he goes, he does the Surya Upasana. And it is said that Surya Upasana is done with two ways. One is the Gayatri Mantra, another is the Surya Namaskar. Both ways the Surya Upasana is done. The third way, there are many other ways to do it. People who meditate on the sun here, and they draw the energy, the prana from the sun, and they do those kind of meditation practices, that they don't need food. They live on the subtle prana with that upasana. So different types of Surya Upasana. Here it is the simple one, Sandhya Vandan is what is said. And earlier day, Sandhya Vandan was happening two times. One in the morning, one in the evening. Then somewhere it became Trikala Sandhya, one afternoon also. So now Bhagwan finally reached Dwarka. When he reached Dwarka, he blew his great conch, Panchajanya. So when he blew his conch, the grief of the people as though went away, that Bhagwan has come. They are missing the Lord. For such a long time he has been out. And such a massive battle he fought. And they won. So they want to give a welcome to Bhagwan also. The victorious, he completed the... He returned victorious. So, this picture, this description which is given here is something that one can meditate upon and visualize the form of Sri Krishna blowing the conch. The conch turned red on account of the contact with the rosy lips of the Almighty Lord and shone resplendent in his lotus palms like a loudly singing swan perched on a pair of red lotus. When the Lord heard, when the Lord blew the conch, even in the Gita you see, that is the description. Panchajanyam Hrishikeshaha Devadattam Dhananjayaha Pandram Dadnav Mahashankham Bhima Karma Vrikodara. Bhagwan blows the conch. That conch by itself is symbolic of destroying tamas, the sound of conch. And the sound of conch will bring the sound of Om. Now Bhagwan blowing that conch is all the more. When one blows the conch, one requires a lot of lung power also. And different types of conches are there. Different sizes of conches also are there. So now Bhagwan is blowing the conch. Welcoming of the Lord itself is enough. And now he is blowing the conch also. So everybody who was waiting, they knew Bhagwan is on the way coming. They all went forth. And each of them had brought some gift, some present. It's like children who take the money from the parent for pocket money and they go and buy a gift for the parent and then give it to the parent on the birthday. It is like that. All these people, with that bhav they have gone. You see, they have written that. I am not saying. They have written, even as children would speak to their father, with that bhav they went. It is like them showing light to the sun. That is the analogy given there. Even as one would offer light to the sun god, their countenance was beaming with joy. They were so happy. Meaning Bhagwan is infinite, pure consciousness. Whatever gift we give to him, what will it be? It is so small. But the bhav is important. With that bhav they went and they started praising the Lord. So the similar stuti we find here, that they bow down to the Lord. The feet of the Lord are adored by Brahma, by Shivji, by Indra, and they are the supreme resort of all those who are aspiring for moksha. Timeless ruler of all is the Lord. They express their gratitude saying that how fortunate we are that you, the Lord of the universe, you are here. We behold your lovely form and you constantly stay with us, the abode of all charms. And your countenance with its loving smiles and affectionate looks, a rare sight even for gods residing in heaven. Then they express their sorrow that whenever you go away to Hastinapur or to Mathura to see various friends, relatives, etc., then they feel very, very sad. Every moment passes without you appears to us as long as a myriad years, and we feel as miserable as ice without the sun. Ice without the sun means? If the sun is not there, if light is not there, ice can't see at all. So the meaning to say that Bhagwan is the sun in their lives. Without the Lord, they feel helpless. They can't grasp anything as though. See, this expression may seem very poetic, but see the bhav which is conveyed in them. who is the sun of our lives, without whom we feel miserable. If that is Bhagwan, then that is bhakti. Right now the sun of our life may be somebody else. It may be my own son also. It may be anyone. Nothing wrong in loving people, but one without whom I will be miserable. For the devotee, it is Bhagwan only. That much bhav when one has. You may say that, no, but that toh Bhagwan was there in front of them in Dwarka and he manifested and he was living there with them. So then they have the bhav. Now Bhagwan is not visible to us. Now how will we have that bhav? That's the test, no? If you have bhav, Bhagwan will become visible also. And who says Bhagwan is not visible? All that we are seeing is Bhagwan only. Bhagwan told us that in the Gita also. Every single thing that is there, all pervasive, is the Lord. If we can't see Him everything, at least see Him in the special manifestations. So all this, the ocean, the sun, the moon, so many things. Form. If that intensity of seeking is there, Bhagwan will manifest as form also. So it's a catch-22 situation. We say that till the form is not there, we don't have bhakti. Until bhakti is not there, form will not manifest. So where will it break? No, Bhagwan has to break it, His compassion. He has to come as form first, then our bhakti will come. That may take many, many years. And by the way, Bhagwan only makes us have satsang, no? How does bhakti even arise? Before He makes the He manifests as form, He only brings satsang in our lives. We saw that earlier also. Satsang doesn't come without grace of Bhagwan. If I have that bhav, that grace of Bhagwan is with me, and I keep increasing my intensity, form will also manifest. So here that's what they say, that they feel lost when Bhagwan goes away. Now all this, they are praising the Lord and Bhagwan enters the city. And this city is guarded by all these different types of groups of the Vrishni clan. All these Madhus, Bhoja, Dasharha, Arha, Kukuras, Andhakas, Vrishnis, all of them, they are guarding this whole Dwarka. And some description about the city is also given there. Lot of festivity is there. People have all gathered there, decorated the whole place. Flags and banners, shapes, signs, all these were there. And they have also put, flowers, rice, all those things, because they have offered that to the Lord. So all that is there everywhere. The entrance of the house in the city was adorned with curd, unbroken rice, fruit, sugarcane, pitcher full of water, offering incense and lights. Each house they have decorated like that. Even today if you see in South India and many places, this type of decoration will be there. Sugarcane will be there with that green leaves and all that. Kolam and everything, all this will be there. So now, when Bhagwan reached and he was going through the streets, who came there? His father, Vasudevji, and Akrur, his Vasudevji's cousin, and Ugrasen. Who is Ugrasen? The father of Kamsa. Kamsa was killed, and then Bhagwan kept Ugrasen on the throne. He was in the jail before, yes. So then he crowned him again. And Ram here means Balram. Pradyumna and Charudeshna, Rukmini's sons. Samba is Jambavati's son. All of them, they quit their beds early, it seems. And some people left their meals also, that Bhagwan has returned. They all kept an elephant in the front, and with all the Brahmanas, with Vedic chants, etc., they have gone to receive the Lord. Now you see how Bhagwan meets each of them. See the 21st one. The Lord on that occasion met his kinsmen and attendants all, attendants as well as the citizens in the appropriate manner, and showed his consideration to all. Now you see, gratifying them all down to the paraya, meaning the person who is a sweeper or considered to be the lowest in the caste hierarchy. What does Bhagavan do? He bows down to all of them. By bowing down his head, greeting in respectful terms, clasping to the bosom, pressing the hands and greeting with the smiles and endearing looks and granting them boons of their choice. He blesses all of them, he meets them, he expresses their love, etc. And then he bows down also to people who are from whom he has to seek blessings. And himself blessed by his elders, the Brahmanas and their wives, the aged folk and the others, including, how do you read this? Panjurists. The Almighty Lord entered the city. See, Bhagwan is in that form. Whatever is appropriate to that form, he does. Age, etc., he respects. Whoever are elders, he bows down to them. Whoever is equal, he expresses their love to his companionship to them, and whoever is below. So that is the three types of vyavahar that one does. For with the elders, one shows respect, bows down. With the equals, one treats them as equals, friendship, all that. And then those who are below, those who are younger, to them express all the love, care, affection, everything. So he takes care of all that. See, all these are small ways by which the dharma samsthapana happens. Otherwise, he can just come as the Lord of the universe. Though the people are looking at him as the Lord of the universe, what is Bhagwan looking at the others as? See, that's the difference in the perception. Bhagwan gives the maryada to each person according to their age, according to their station in life, according to their gender, according to their varna, everything. So that's a quality of a leader who will do appropriate connection with each person. So now, all as the Lord is passing by, the women in Dwarka also, they have gone up upon their mansions, and you see, the description of the Lord is now given there. We will read from this 25.
Swamiji, I have a question. In this, I don't know the Hindi version, from verse 15 onwards, certain of them are these footnotes. In number 1, 2, 3, 4, Niche mein they given some Deepa Dupa Kaili, Charu San, Sambhagagaya.
Okay, I don't know which is. In this one, there is nothing. How come it's not there in English? I don't know. So this footnotes, yeah, Purna Kumbhair Balibhir Dhupa Deepakaihi. So that is the ritual, how they welcomed him. That is the first one. Then, yeah, Pradyumna Sambha, Charu Sambhadayaha. Brahman is to Samalinga. some are extra here. Yeah, some things are extra here.
So Purna Kumbha is given here. Pictures are full of pictures water, offering incense and lights, so that dhupa dipa and.
That is the translation here. See, that's the translation of the Purna Kumbhaihi Balibhihi Dhupa Deepakaihi. That's the translation here. Then they have given here Charu Samba Gadadayaha. So this is Pradyumnas Charu Deshnascha Sambo Jambavati Sutaha. For that they have given. Here in our English translation, they have just given Pradyumna and Charu Deshna, Rukmini's sons, and Samba Jambavati's sons.
And the translation they have given as you read out, because I don't know why they gave this.
That's what I'm trying to see. In the first two, Brahmana. Brahmana is to Samalan.
Sumangalai. That's what. It is nothing different.
Puraskritya Brahmana.
Sa Sumangalai. These are all footnotes 1, 2, 3, 4. So wherever they have given the numbers to those, like near Sambo, they have written 1.
Pati Jagna.
Parakayaha 9. So if you read 9. Pati
Jagna.
So, in previous edition, it was written like that. That word with that spelling. Generally, it is like.
What one?
He said that in the previous edition, it used to be read like that, like the footnote. This is
kind of footnotes.
Right.
So, where numbers are given, like you see number 8. It says Puram, and in the footnote it is written Purim, number 8, on page number 132.
Oh, this is a mother book only.
No, it's the same book. Bhagwatam.
No, it's my page 88. Hai.
Achha, to aap kab pehle
kaha? 88. Hai. Only few are little different, that's what I'm trying to see. Only 3-4. That's only, I think, a description a little more, like here, though they have given in the brackets, no? That I think must be here in the footnotes.
No, I think previous.
Oh, this Sanskrit one is the previous edition ka, that you are saying. So those are not notes. The notes, like notes in this English one, if you see, they have given notes separately. I don't know whether that's there in the Hindi. Like suppose you take the next chapter, no? When this, the right royal reception of Sri Krishna at Dwarka, in that if you see, for verse number 30, there is a footnote. One asterisk is there, and then Yajnavalkya Smriti says,
yeah.
That is a proper footnote.
Yeah.
In Hindi edition, is it there?
Yes, sir.
That is there as a footnote?
Yes.
So that is the footnote. So this other one is a different version, possibly.
Yes.
Sanskrit version, yeah.
It goes throughout the Bhagavatam. Even here they have pra, and then again number.
Pra ka full form kya hai? See in the glossary, the appendix or glossary, they must have given that.
Yeah, because upar it is dhupa dhupake, here it's dhipa dhupake.
So that's a version difference. Right. Right. We will read from this 25th shloka. This a few nice things about the form of the Lord is given here.
Next page.
25, shloka 25. No, 26, sorry. Nityam nirikshamananam yadapi dvarakaikasam navitrupyanti hidrishaha shriyo dhamangam achyutam shriyo nivaso yasyoraha panapatram mukham drisham bahavo lokapalanam saranganam padambujam. सितातपत्रव्यजनैरुपस्कृतः प्रसूनवर्षैरभिवर्षितः पथि पिशङ्गवासा वनमालया बभौ घनो यथार्को दुपचापवैद्युतैः. इट् इस् अ फार्म् आफ् द लार्ड्. वाट् डस् इट् से हियर्? नित्यं निरीक्षमाणानां यदपि द्वारकैकसाम्. This is 25, no?
Yes.
Those who are constantly looking at him from the tops of the Dwarka, I think, mansions. Nahi vitrupyanti hidrishaha. They don't feel satisfied. Shriyo dhamangam achyutam. Seeing the whole body, the form of Bhagwan. Shriyo dhama is where Mother Lakshmi or Shri is in the chest of Bhagwan. Shriyodhamangam achyutam. Shriyo nivaso yasyo raha. That is that, yeah. Panapatram mukham drisham. And a cup of nectar for all eyes to drink from. Then bahavo lokapalanam. His arms are the guardians of the whole world. Lokapalas. There are these lokapalas supposed to be the guardians of the different worlds. Seven up, seven down lokapalas. Meaning the hands of the Lord as though. So it's like a Virat Roop type of a... Not exactly like that, but something similar to that. Then what are his feet? His lotus-like feet are the home of the bee-like devotees. Each limb is an embodiment of elegance. The eyes of the residents of Dwarka, they did not knew any satiety. That's the thing. They did not feel tripti when they saw this form of the Lord. Though they beheld him every day. Human forms and other people we see, then after some time we get bored. Bhagwan's form one keeps seeing and they never get bored at all. With the white umbrella spread over his head and a pair of chauris waving both the sides, flowers raining all around, the Lord was clad in yellow robes and adorned with his garland of sylvan flowers, shone on the road like a cloud with the sun shining overhead. A pair of moons moving in circle about it, stars scattered all around and a rainbow and flashes of lightning illumining it. These are things to visualize. The devotee will just visualize this, ki Bhagwan is going in the chariot. And these chauris are like this, what they say, these two things, na? The pair of moons, there are two moons, they are the chauris. And on the top is the sun. And the cloud is like the chhatri, all that. Good thing if somebody wants to paint. You can paint, visualize the Lord. More important, what is it? That Bhagwan must be there in our heart on this type of a rath. Blowing the conch, removing our ignorance, controlling our senses, all that. Now that he entered, where did he go? He first went to meet his parents. See that. Pravishtastu gruham pitroho parishvakta samatrubhihi bhavande shirasa sapta devaki pramukha muda. This you have to tell me. Seven mothers, who are the seven mothers of Bhagwan? Devaki is the main one. Who are the rest of the six? Huh? But Yashoda and all of them are not there. They are not there. If anybody finds out, please tell me. Who are the seven mothers of Bhagwan? Eight wives we found out. Seven mothers we have to find. best part is this only. Bhagwan is ekamaiva advitiya, but everything else is in multitudes. Seven mothers and eight wives and 16,000 wives. And but he is only one. All the connections with him are all more than one. So seven mothers, Devaki and all of them, he bowed down to them and they were so full of joy and happiness. Milk started flowing from their breasts. He next entered his own palace. After that he went to his palace. And what kind of a palace he must be having, you think? 16,000 wives are there. All of them are waiting for him. Dongreji Maharaj has written that he did such a leela that all the wives felt he came first to me only. So he made them all feel very special. So he went there and they were all waiting for him. They felt overjoyed at heart to behold from distance their Lord who had returned after a long absence. And they abandoned their seats and their thought of him. They abandoned their thought of him also. Why? Because they were till now imagining him, thinking about him. Now he is right there in front. And austerity also. So see, traditionally what they have written here. In Yajnavalkya Smriti it is said, Kridam Sharira Samskaram Samajot Savadarshanam Hasyam Paragrihe Yanam Tyajet Proshita Bhartrika. A woman whose husband is away from her should give up amusement, decoration of her body, visiting social functions, jesting and calling at another's house. This is said at that time. That is a culture. No, I am just saying, this is said at that time. That is the culture of that time. And possibly it is also much more traditional culture in that sense that women were more protected in that sense, and as well as the people also. It's not about restricting the freedom of women. It is about the mindset. They also felt that my husband is away. Might as well stay indoors. Today that doesn't happen many times. So now we have a lot of troubles also happening, no? Extramarital affair, this, that, everything happens.
Swamiji, can I ask a question, please? Why is it that it's 16,000 wives? What is the symbolism of 16,000?
16,000 wives, there's a lot of symbolism there because then one is the story, you know, Narakasura, he had captured the 16,000 princes and he was supposed to sacrifice all of them to become immortal, and then Satyabhama comes there with Bhagwan and they go to that Amravati, and then Bhagwan kills this. Satyabhama actually kills. When Narakasura is killed, then all these 16,000 princes say, now who will accept us? Because this demon Narakasura has captured us. Society is not going to accept us. And you are the Lord of the universe. We surrender to you. You protect us. So one is from that aspect that they all surrendered and Bhagwan gave them protection. Symbolic aspect is that these are 16,000 thought varieties. That's what Gurudev explains, that these are 16,000 thought varieties and each and every thought is married to consciousness. Without consciousness, thought cannot exist. And hence, Gurudev would define, no, thought is equal to object plus consciousness. So each and every thought is as though surrendered to the Lord, and human mind can think in 16,000 thought possibilities. So from adhyatmic standpoint, it is that. From adibhautic standpoint, it is that these princes are to be protected. So that's how it is. The story is. Now symbolism of it is Narakasura, Naraka. One who considers oneself as the body, that is called Naraka. Narakasura is the ego. And ego has captured all these 16,000 thought varieties to glorify himself or herself and then to become immortal by name, fame or whatever. So that yajna is supposed to be all the actions that one does to achieve success, name, fame. And through that the ego wants to remain immortal, remain in this world, known to people, popularity and all that. And even after death that name will remain. So that's how the ego thinks, and then the ego has captured all the 16,000 thought varieties. When the jiva surrenders to Bhagwan, ego gets destroyed. Then ego destroyed, surrenders to the Lord, all these thought varieties, they will go to the Lord. So that's the adhyatmic meaning, symbolism. There it is that Bhagwan had to marry 16,000, and Bhagwan marrying 16,000 is... Bhagwan actually is the Purusha. The only Purusha is the Lord. Everything else is Prakriti. 16,000 is what? Bhagwan is married to everybody, actually speaking. None of us will exist without Bhagwan. So 16,000 there is just a symbolic aspect. If we say 16,000 is because of this thought varieties, etc. And the Leela there Bhagwan is doing, so there it is 16,000 princes. But otherwise, really speaking, each one is wedded to the Lord only. So that is one. Now here they say that, see how Bhagwan also, he has come after a long time. So what do? They embrace the Lord mentally and then by their sight and then physically. First they mentally embrace him, then when they see him, they visualize embracing him, and then they actually go and embrace him. And with their, lastly by their body, as well through their babes. I don't understand why they have written babes. Babes means child. Babies, na? I didn't know what is the meaning, because babes nowadays means something else. So I had to go to dictionary and find out what is babes mean. Then it is written son, and okay, understandable, okay, son it is. So with their children, so they went, they embraced him, and you see, he has returned after a long time, so they had tears. You know, they had so far kept within the corners of their eyes, out of their bashful nature, now trickled down in spite of themselves. They could no longer control their emotions. So out of joy, they feel so happy that Bhagwan has come. And his feet appear to them as full of fresher charm every moment. Such a nice line is given. See, what woman would cease to love those feet, which even Sri cannot abandon even for a moment, though noted for her fickleness. Meaning Lakshmi Devi is supposed to be fickle in her physical form as money. Otherwise, mentally though she is there. I mean, the Adhidaivik form, she is always there at the feet of Vishnu Bhagwan. She doesn't go. But in the physical form as money, Lakshmi Devi is very fickle. That Lakshmi Devi who is so fickle in that physical form, but she will never leave feet of Bhagwan. That analogy is given here, that those feet of the Lord, whom Lakshmi Devi never leaves, who will leave the feet? What woman would cease to love those feet? Now what had Bhagwan done? The example given here is just like the bamboos when they rub against each other and then there's some sparks of fire and then that whole thing catches fire. In the same way, this Pandavas, Kauravas and all the allies of these both, when they fought with each other, Bhagwan established dharma and he was now peaceful, he was now very silent. So having accomplished the great task of establishing dharma, when Bhagwan has now come back, it was that same Lord who is appeared in this mortal form in the world in his own playful way. He started sporting in the midst of thousands of most charming women like a worldly man. Now, so many people take this and they just quote If Krishna had 16,008 wives, why should we not have? But Krishna danced on Kaliya, you also dance. Krishna drank poison at the age of 6 months, you also drink. He lifted Govardhan Parvat on this one touch, you know, small finger. We can't lift one suitcase properly. You know, so that simple, you know, we just want to malign the culture or tell something nasty about our Lord. That is stupid. Because what is said here now, that is very beautiful. That Bhagavan was engaging in all this, but he was absolutely unaffected by any of this. You see, Kamdev, he had got defeated in Ras Leela in Vrindavan. The Sharad Purnima night when Ras Leela happened, there was no calm in the mind of Bhagwan nor in the mind of the gopis. They were thinking of Bhagwan as the supreme being. And there also they got a little pride that, you know, Bhagwan is playing with us. The moment they got a pride, Bhagwan vanished. Ras Leela is supposed to be the highest expression of bhakti. That people say he was flirting with women in the middle of the night, they left their husbands and came, and all kinds of nonsense people talk. My point of saying is, Kamdev could not enter the mind of Bhagwan or the gopis at that time. Now, Kamdev thought, I will try at least here, because there it is bhakta and Bhagwan relationship. Here it is husband and wife relationship. But Kamdev got defeated here also. You see what is written so nicely, it is there, that stung, this 36th verse, stung by their guileless and winsome smiles and bashful looks that bespoke their profound love, even Cupid fainted and dropped his bow. These jewels among women, however, could not disturb the serenity of his mind by their amorous gestures. Kamdev could not enter into Bhagavan's mind. Finding him actively engaged like themselves, the people, ignorant as they are, look upon him who is absolutely unattached as a human being full of attachment. You see, this is where it is. We will see Bhagavan only the way we see from our level. If my mind is impure, Bhagavan's act will also appear impure. If my mind is pure, Bhagavan's act will not appear impure at all. It's there in my head. Each devotee's head only it is. So those who are ignorant will consider him as an ordinary human being and then engaging in all these pleasures. Herein lies the divinity of the Almighty Lord, that even though abiding in Prakriti, he never gets tainted by the gunas of Prakriti. Just as a mind that has taken refuge in him is never contaminated by the gunas of Prakriti. So we have a choice where to take refuge, in the gunas of Prakriti or in the Lord. Identifying with the gunas of Prakriti, which is this body, mind, intellect, then we feel of ourselves as jiva. Then we see things as finite, then having sense enjoyments, and then get attached to them. Here is the devotee who is not like that. See this line, na? 38th one. Etadishanamishasya prakritisthopi tadgunaihi nayujyate sadatmasthaihi yatha buddhistadashrayaha. That's a beautiful line. We, those who take refuge in Bhagwan, will not get affected by the three gunas of Prakriti, just like Bhagwan, who is the Lord of the three gunas, remains unaffected. So, attached. Tam mani re bala mudhaha strainam chanu vratam rahaha apramana vido bhartuhu ishwaram matayo yatha. He says, those ignorant ladies, themselves little knowing his greatness, looked upon him as a henpecked husband. Devoted to their service in private chamber, even as the notions of aham conceive of God as sharing their own characteristics. So those, among those 16,000, if they saw him because of ignorance, as though Bhagwan is giving in to their demands, then that is power of maya and delusion only. Now that's what it is. Even if Bhagwan is right in front and one has that opportunity, if the mind is not pure, nothing, one can't see. So if they saw him as the Lord, then they always were unattached, like Krishna Bhagavan himself was unattached. But if they saw him as an ordinary human being, then what lines are used? See, Mudha Strainam Chanuvratam Virahaha. If they are deluded, then that's where it is. So now this part ends the portion. Now Bhagavan has reached Dwarka. Now Shaunakji is asking about the birth of Parikshit. That what happened to that? Because the Katha got left there. As far as birth of Parikshit is concerned, Ashwathama hit the missiles, Krishna Bhagavan saved. That's all, over. What happened after that further was not explained. Then that Yudhishthir and Bhishma and all those things came. Yudhishthir's grief and all that we saw. So now Shaunak Rishi, he again picks up from there. So what he says, Ashwathama Nopasrishtena Brahma Shishno Rutejasa Uttaraya Hato Garbha Ishena Jivita Punaha. See, here to what is said, Shaunak Rishi is saying that the child was dead and it was brought to life by Bhagwan. But Sutaji, when he replies, Sutaji says, no, Bhagwan was guarding him. So Sutaji never does not say that, you know, the child died. But Shaunak Rishi in his question is asking that. The infant in the womb of Uttara, though destroyed by the formidable Brahmastra discharged by Ashwathama, was brought back to life by the Lord himself. Now he wants to listen to the birth and the work of Parikshit Raja. That what happened to him, how was he born? And such a great soul to whom Shukdev imparted the knowledge. How did he die and what happened to him after death? Everything from birth to work to death and then after death. He says, kindly narrate this to us. So now Sutaji starts. This description is what was said earlier, you know, that Yudhishthir was ruling the kingdom. And he had lot of wealth, etc. And he made lot of sacrifices, everything. So this is where it is that we have to figure out that doubt which we had that time. No, we thought that he did 3 Ashwamegha Yajnas before. But here again they pick up the same thing and they say that Yudhishthir was ruling and then he was, you know, having lot of wealth, etc. And he was ruling the whole world, but his main place was this Jambudvipa, and his fame reached up to heaven. But one thing nice he said is, but could all these objects of enjoyment coveted even by gods or brahmanas bring delight to the king who had given his mind to Krishna? That Yudhishthir also had surrendered to Krishna. So his mind was not affected by this power and pleasure and all that. While being scorched by the fire of Brahmastra, that hero in the womb of his mother Shaunak. Now all this when it has happened, that connection is what I am not able to understand properly here. Maybe some other commentaries if they have written that. It is said actually that he did 3 yajnas and all that before. And then this astra was released by Ashwathama. So when this Ashwathama is released, Matur Garbhagato Viraha Satada Bhrigunandanao Dadarsha Purusham Kanchid Dahyamano Astra Tejasa. So now when this astra was released, the child in the womb, he sees one resplendent divine Purusha. The child is feeling the heat, but this effulgent being, size of a thumb, angushta matram amalam, sphurat purata maulinam, apichya darshanam shyamam, tadidvasa samachyutam. There is this size of the thumb, so small, charming appearance, swarthy of hue, clad in yellow robes, shone like lightning and wearing a brilliant diadem of gold. He was no other than Lord Achyuta. He had four long graceful arms adorned with pendants of refined gold, bloodshot eyes, and held in one of his hands a mace that shone like a firebrand, even as he waved it in a circle again and again, himself revolving around the child all the time. He was quenching the fire of Brahmastra. Bhagwan was saving this Parikshit. And see, Parikshit already is feeling the fire because he is in the womb. There is Jataragni already there. The mother's body's heat is already there. Now that Brahmastra also is hit. Now Bhagwan is protecting him from all that. And even as sun disperses the fog, how sun disperses the fog so effortlessly, in that way it is Bhagwan just protected this child. And Bhagwan, who is infinite by nature, when the work was over, he disappeared in the womb itself. And the child of 10 months was still looking on. So 10 months the child was there inside. Which means at the 10th month only this has happened. When that Ashwamedha Yajna etc. was done, that we don't know. Because how did he get untold riches? At the end of the war, though, there would be devastation and disaster. Anyway, let's see if some clarification comes ahead. So now the child is born, which was favorable time. Tata sarva guno darke sanukula grahodaye jagne vamshadhara pandoho bhuya panduriva ujasa. Just like Pandu, the child was born. Pandu literally means white, dhaval, resplendent means Pandu. So, as brilliant as Pandu, this child was born to carry forward the lineage of the Pandavas. And that happened by, because Bhagwan's grace, Bhagwan protected. At the right time, which is favorable to develop all the good values. Sarva guno darke. Guna uda arke. Guno darke. Arka is that time, sun. So, at the right time, when all positions are fine, graha udaye, all the right grahas etc. are there, at that time this child is born. And when this child was born, all of them are so delighted. The hymns and rites etc. connected with the birth of the child are performed by the brahmanas. The names are given, Dhaumya, Kripa and others. It is said here, the king who knew the right moment for making gifts bestowed at the sacred hour of the birth of Parikshit before the navel string is cut. So it is said that the sutak will start after the navel string is cut. So after the sutak starts, you cannot do rites, ritual, dan, etc. for 10 days. So the king knew that. So before the navel string is cut, the king did all the... That's the reason why that birth time is also very, very important. Not only for astrology, but even to do all these rites, rituals, etc. Because after that 10 days, you cannot do. I will come to that. Why? So all this gold, cow, land, village, all this given, excellent elephant, horses, best food grains, all given to Brahmanas. Now Brahmanas, what did they say? They said that by the will of providence, which cannot be balked, this stainless race of the Purus had all but died out, but Bhagwan protected by saving the child. Hence, the child will be known in the world by the name as Vishnu Ratha. Ratha, one is protected by Vishnu. So he says here, see the verse number 16 it is. Daivena pratighatena shukle samstha mupeyushi rato vonugrahaarthaya vishnuna prabha vishnuna. So his name is Vishnu Ratha. Tasman namna Vishnu Ratha iti loke brahat shravaha bhavishyatina sandeho mahabhagavato mahan. See that? He said without doubt he will be a mahabhagavat. Mahabhagavat means the greatest of the devotees. The devotees of the Lord is called Mahabhagavat. What is the glory of a Mahabhagavat? You think about it. That a crocodile you see Gajendra Moksha, when it will come, no? The crocodile was holding the leg of that Gajendra, elephant. And in pain, Gajendra cried out to Bhagwan. Bhagwan came and with his Sudarshan Chakra, he cut the neck of this crocodile. And the crocodile died. But then crocodile got mukti. Before Gajendra, crocodile got mukti. Why? Because Gajendra only called out to Bhagwan. Crocodile was holding the feet of the devotee of Bhagwan. That's the power of the Mahabhagavat. And the das of that Mahabhagavat is much more. Here, of course, it was not with some devotion. That was some, you were wanting to, but that the significance of that analogy is to say how a Mahabhagavat or a devotee is so great. That Bhagwan blesses even that person who accidentally is catching the, you know, feet of this Mahabhagavat. So he says, your, this great grandchild will become Bhavishyati na sandeho. There is no doubt, he will be a Mahabhagavat Mahan. Greatest amongst the great devotees of the Lord. Exalted soul, yeah. Then he says, Yudhishthir says, will the child share the good reputation of the glorious and the high royal sages of his own line? So then they explain some more things about Parikshit Raja that we will take up in our next session. Now, why is this sutak happening there? See, when the birth of a child happens, it is called sutak. And when the death of a person happens, it is called patak. So when this umbilical cord is cut, so when we do a ritual, in our culture, ritual, when we do, we are worshipping Bhagwan. Purity of mind is very, very important. Purity of speech is important. Purity of body is important. And that's why the first part of a puja always will be purifying. Purify the pranas, purify the body, purify the speech, purify, you know, put the mantra, achaman, all that. Purify the samagri, directions, everything. So ritual purity is very important. When a child is born, what happens? Two things happen. One is that the mother, see, another point is this, yes. Any secretions when they are coming out of the body, then the body is considered impure, including running nose, vomit, all that. In those conditions, when there is secretions in the body happening, then one says that purity required to perform the ritual is not there. And so it is that anybody at such times is not considered fit for doing a worship. When the child is born, the body of the mother, one is that it is exhausted after giving birth. And then they say there are secretions that keep happening. And 10 days it takes, the body also emits odor. And 10 days it takes for the body of the mother also to settle down or whatever. So they say those 10 days, the woman doesn't go out of the house. And people in that house also will not go to the public places like temples, etc. And they will not worship the deity also. Why? Because that soul which has come into that, we don't know which jiva has come. So that shuddhi also has to happen. And those 10 days, if they go out, meet people, then they come in home and then meet the baby also will have infections. The baby also will catch whatever, germs or whatever it is. Immunity of the baby is not very strong enough. So they say for those 10 days, public places one avoids. The mother doesn't go out, stays at home only. And according to their varna, the number of days of sutak also is different. Why? Because the work involved is different. So for the Brahmana Varna, the sutak is only for 10 days. 10 days.
10 is minimum.
Yeah, 10 is minimum. Kshatriya and Vaishya, it is between 16 and 21. And for Shudra, it is 30. this one says 30, whatever, 30, 40. So, why it is like that? Because the labor that a Shudra woman has to do is much more intense. The body requires that much time to prepare itself for that hard work. So, 30 days, be in that. Take care. So, two reasons. One is ritual purity and second is the jiva. The jiva who has come, we don't know which jiva who has come. So, they consider that whole lineage. They have to live in austerity for some time, abstaining from various other things, and then after that you go out. Similar thing they will do for Patak also. When the jiva departs. When the jiva departs, then those rituals have to be done. Antyeshti karma, etc. have to be done, and after that the Shraddha karma will be done after 13th day. Because the 12 days is the Patak period, where the soul is still in the Bhuvar Loka, before it goes ahead to the, according to its karma, to whichever Loka, and the soul still has attachment to the body, so the body has to be disposed of very fast, and then you cremate, and you see there also, they have lot of, if you read Garuda Puran, there is, in Garuda Puran, there is this whole portion, 16th chapter or something, it is some chapter, where they tell to whom Sutak applies, to whom it doesn't apply. Like a soldier who is dying fighting, then the Sutak doesn't apply to the family here because the whole cremation and everything is done there. Somebody who dies abroad, Sutak doesn't apply to the whole family. So hygiene was one definite reason why they did it, possibly. And also that when the antyeshti karma etc. is not done, then there is no need of a sutak. Because the people who go to the crematorium, they will also get affected. Certain sutaks which are there, they will go away by the simple process of bath. So it's a very detailed thing, but basic gist is only the ritual purity, the body and the condition of the mind and the hygiene factor is what I understand. And of course the jiva, the yatra of the jiva. So which jiva has come at birth and where this jiva is going afterwards, because the jiva is still connected, please remember that much part. The mind of the jiva is still connected to everybody. So where the jiva goes, what the jiva experiences will also affect us as much as what we do will affect the jiva. So in that Patak period of 10 days, one doesn't do any rituals. 13. Sutak is 10, first one. This one is 13. After the 12th, on the 13th day one has to do. So more details you may find in the Garuda Puran, but this is the gist of it.
Swamiji, sometimes like after families, we observe, we call it by different names, Suha and Sutta. I think one is after birth and one is after death. So sometimes what happens is a baby is born somewhere, say somewhere in the Somali family, in some city of the world, maybe in India also, the baby is born. And what we do is, we apply that Suha to all the families all over who are directly related.
It applies.
So, all wherever you are.
Yes.
And even as far as the death is concerned.
Yes, it will apply to all. But what level of Sutak will apply is different.
We stop doing puja and
Yes. Because the ritual impurity is there at that point in time. Okay. Because that's why I said, you know, the lineage gets affected.
So, even for a baby's
birth? Yeah. Which jiva has come into your lineage now, you don't know. And also this one, and that's why the baby's purification happens first. The baby's purification happens and then the other things one will start. Same way here also, when that jiva is gone, the pitrus are worshipped in those 10 days. Bhagavan is not worshipped. The pitrus are, because the jiva is going to proceed towards the pitrulok, so the pitrus will be worshipped in those 10 days. And then, after that Patak gets over, then they will worship the Lord. So, from this standpoint of Sutak, etc., even Gita chanting and all that, one does not do. One doesn't visit the temple. After 13th day only one does.
No, but in our, like the,
Ritualistic worship. I am not sure of that. I will check from Garuda Puran and I will tell you. Because Bhagwan's worship is not there, only Pitru's worship is there, that's what I read. But does it include chanting of the Gita, not include that, I don't know.
Actually, Brahmins comes to our house and they're chanting. So, like, usually we are supposed to do Garuda Puran, but it's very...
You are not supposed to do Baba, that's why you call Brahman.
Brahmin comes and do, but what I'm saying is, no, that's so much of like painful description is given in Garuda Puran. So people avoid that, you are scared of all those things. So then they do the Gita chanting.
अब देखो convenience से अगर कुछ बदल दिया है वो दूसरी बात है. But Garuda Puran is what is supposed to be chanted because the Brahman will do. You are not supposed to chant, the Brahman will chant and then he will explain to you this is what is written and these are the things that you are supposed to do for the sadgati of that Jivatma. It is like giving food to them because the Jiva is hungry and thirsty and how does the Jiva connect? So then all the description is there. So then one does all that, offers it and that the subtle essence of that goes to the Jiva, that the whole science there.
Yeah.
Shastra so says that only.
Listen to the description also.
Yeah. Because it does two purposes. One is it will make me aware what the Jiva Yatra is after I drop the body. So that I should also start learning to live my life better here and now. Second, it will help the Jiva in the journey ahead. So it's supposed to be done.
3 days they call for Gita. So in 17th chapter they do it, and then 18th chapter they do on the last day, 13th day.
Possible. Now I don't know the technicalities of this. Now I'll find out and tell you.
No. Plus nowadays people have started making it convenient.
No, that's also. One is convenience factor is a different thing. But see what scripture say we'll figure out. What people are doing now, then we'll have to see how much is convenience based and that's a choice. But what the scripture is saying, why the soothak applies and all that. Because that purity of the ritual is there in every culture.
Yes.
Well, there is Christianity also.
Even the food,
yeah.
After we wash the whole and then we keep
fresh. For?
After
fresh food for?
It
will be hygiene factor.
So again, if someone has happened in some other city, only in Calcutta, then hygiene.
No, that's what I'm saying. There are two points in this. One is ritual purity and one is the hygiene factor. Hygiene factor, that's why the sutak, the Shastra clearly says if somebody is there, out there, then this type of sutak will not apply, but the other one will apply. So those rules are given there. Because one is hygiene factor, but the second is the Jiva is there. No, one new Jiva has come into your cooler. Who is that Jiva? From where that Jiva has come? What is the past baggage of that Jiva? Nobody knows. And hence that purity of the Jiva is done, then it will affect the whole Kula also. Once that Jiva gets purified, then everybody also starts doing. So that can be anywhere. Whoever is anywhere else, the entire lineage of that person will get affected. That family. So wherever they are, Sutak period will apply to them.
So then we have to do the ritual part also and the kitchen part also, both. Or only the
kitchen part is only kitchen.
Ritual part.
No, that ritual part applies to everybody.
No, but that ritual part only applies in a certain way to different people. Depends on which type of birth has happened, where it has happened. That's why I'm saying ki 10 days ke liye, if the child is born here. See, birth ka sutak is different from death ka sutak again. Child can be born wherever. I think for birth part of it applies common to everybody. In terms of the ritual, only the number of days of sutak varies based on the varna of that person, yeah. But death ka sutak, whether it applies or not, also depends on where the jiva has died. So the Garuda Puran, etc., they are read out, but this limitation of going out and not going out, that is not there. If the person has died far away, that is a hygiene factor. The ritual part of it will apply, and how much will it apply according to the varnas or how many days it will apply, that will change. But the food part, the meeting part, going out part, that will change according to the place of the death. Because cremation, burial, so they say for children, small children and boys and girls, they don't even cremate. One has to only bury. Now why all that is there, we have to read. So we'll figure out how it is. Garuda Puran, if you have, open it and read. And find out about this sutak. That which, I think 16th chapter or some such chapter it is. I'll put on the group. पढ़के देखना फिर उसमें क्या क्या लिखा है सूतक के बारे में. एंड इफ यू हैव एनी डाउट्स गो एंड आस्क सम पंडित, डोंट कम टू मी. व्हाई आई एम सेइंग, बिकॉज़ आई एम नॉट एन अथॉरिटी ऑन दैट, आई डोंट नो. अरे नॉट लाइक दैट, यू कैन आस्क शारदानंद जी और सम सच पर्सन हु हैज प्रॉपर नॉलेज अबाउट द रिचुअल. या And if you question the Pandit, no, if 100 people question the Pandit, that Pandit will also tighten himself up. Ab hum usko poochte hi nahi prashna.
Some are very good.
That's why there will be some who will know. And those who don't know, unko pakad ke poocho. Pareshan ho jane chahiye wo, ki are humko ye dakshina nahi milegi jab tak iska uttar nahi denge. Some, then only one will learn. No, then.